Welcome back. This is our sixth show in a series of shows entitled Rehabilitation Coming Soon, where we have been discussing the mass incarceration practices of the United States and those and their effect on the state of Hawaii. I am Aaron Wills. I'm a William S. Richardson's Law School graduate and a consultant for retired Judge Mike Towns' private mediation practice. On the previous shows, we have been discussing the current criminal justice system and the punitive punishment model our prisons currently operate under. Our hope throughout these shows is to enlighten and educate our audience on the possibility of whether jails and prisons can be a place of healing and rehabilitation. Last week, our guest was Warden Mark Patterson, who co-authored an article titled, Can Prisons Be a Place of Healing? Mark's idea of how a pu'uhoʻonua would operate in a prison setting and start a healing process is exactly the kind of rehabilitation our jails and prisons need. Before we start this week, I would like to just bring light to an article that was written. You know, it's important to understand that we're not the only group talking about rehabilitation in prisons. And just recently, an article came out in the Civil Beat, and it was written earlier this week, and it's entitled Criminal Justice Reform Fails to Get Much Legislative Love. And basically, the gist of the article is that there is no political momentum to correct the problem that we have in the criminal justice system currently. And we need to get some political momentum. So we'll be talking about that. Our topic this week will be to continue discussing the criminal justice system with the Deputy Chief Judge of the Family Court of the First Circuit, Judge Mark Browning. Judge Browning has served as a judge for over 20 years. In 2011, Judge Browning was appointed as a senior family court judge, and he is the Deputy Chief of the First Circuit. Judge Browning was the presiding judge of the juvenile drug court for 8 years. Prior to becoming a judge, Judge Browning was a prosecuting attorney for 4 years. He was then an associate at a firm before becoming partner in 1989. Judge Browning serves on boards for Friends of Foster Kids and Hawaii Foster Youth Coalition. Some recent awards that Judge Browning has received are the Newey Award for Distinguished Contribution by an Individual from Volunteer Legal Services, the Starfish Award from Hawaii State Foster Parents Association, the Improved Justice Award from the Mediation Center of the Pacific, the Angel in Adoption Award from the U.S. Congress, the Daniel K. Inouye Award from the Hawaii Psychological Association Board of Directors, the Outstanding Judicial Achievement Award from Family Women Lawyers, and the Judiciary Jurist of the Year Award. So thank you for your time and welcome, Judge Browning.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Well, we're going to start off our questions a little differently than we have before with all our guests, and because we really want their insight on how they feel that we could change the system. So what changes would you make? Or in other words, if you had the power to make 3 changes in our current criminal justice system or correctional system, what 3 changes would those be?
Okay, so I'm going to answer this specifically with respect to the juvenile justice system.
Okay.
And I think that in terms of the totality of this discussion, one of the things I should tell you is that we've been in the process of reforming the juvenile justice system for at least over 10 years and made great strides. I think that if I were to change the way the system exists now, in terms of helping the population of kids that we serve and the families that we serve, there's no question that we need more health services, mental health services, okay, for children. And that is an area that ties directly to issues of incarceration at times. Also, there's no question that we could do better with respect to the kinds of substance abuse issues that we see in terms of providing services.
Right.
And then I think, with respect to the third point, you know, there are a number of other things that I could add, but I think that given the current situation that exists now, we have 2 basic prisons for children in this state. One is a pretrial detention center,
right,
which is connected to family court,
okay,
and exists or is physically set in Kapolei next to our courthouse. And the other is HYCF, which Mark Patterson talked about and he's in charge of. I think one of the problems that we face in the juvenile justice system as a state is that we are a state of islands, and so those particular facilities are facilities that are specific to kids throughout the state, so that when kids And there are certain cases when kids are incarceration is warranted, namely when there are issues with respect to public safety that are compelling. Right. But the fact of the matter is that the way the system is set up now, kids from different islands are sent to one facility, so that the kids who are really harmed by that in many ways are the kids from the neighbor islands, because they're separated not only from their families but from their communities. Mm. So a kid from the Big Island who is sent to DH is separated from all the various different folks that could provide support, that would be able to help him or her with the issues that he or she is dealing with.
Right.
And probably if we had a scenario where we could keep kids on their respective islands, we'd have better outcomes.
And that would take a lot of money to build an individual DH center on each island. Would that be a better solution than the one we have currently?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know about the money situation. Obviously, it would cost money. But
right.
If we're talking about kids, in any given time, so we take DH or we look at the population in HYCF, sometimes over half the kids there are from the neighbor islands. Mm. That's significant.
Yeah.
That's disproportionate.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's a third, still significant,
yep.
Still concerning. So yes, I mean, I think there needs to be a better way of dealing with that.
Okay.
Whether it means building different facilities, I don't know. But, you know, if we talk about a dearth of services with respect to juveniles on this island, it's worse on the neighbor islands. There are less services on the neighbor islands.
Well, as I stated in my introduction, there are some who believe, and particularly Mark Patterson, that prisons in particular can be a place of healing. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, it's kind of a wild idea, because that's not the current way we run our penal system. Can prisons be a place of healing for us?
Mark is an amazing guy, and I've known him for some time, and I know what he's doing there.
Yeah.
And if anybody can make HYCF a place of healing, he can. And it's about mindset and about what you're doing, and it's about how you approach these kids and the mentality and the culture that exists that he's trying to change.
Right.
And I think he's being successful. As a system as a whole, in fact, if you look at our court system, you know, the mission statement, the vision statement that I wrote for family court a number of years ago includes, with respect to the vision statement itself, includes a number of different sort of points of aspiration. And the number one point is to be a place of healing. Mm. Not just the prisons, but the courts as a whole. Mm. What's significant, I think, to put in context this conversation regarding incarceration is it's a little bit different conversation when you talk about adults versus kids and the way
yeah.
we do things.
Mm-hmm.
What I mean by that is that, you know, in district court and circuit court, CRIM, in the criminal courts, when judges deal with individuals who are allegedly who have been charged with crimes. The mm-hmm. first issue is the issue of whether or not the individual is guilty or innocent.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sometimes decided by juries, depending upon the case, and sometimes decided by judges. The second responsibility that a judge has after managing the case with respect to guilt or innocence is if that individual is found guilty, that the judge is responsible for sentencing. And sentencing usually in the adult court has to do with deterrence, has to do with punishment.
Right.
That's completely different with respect to what our judges do. Juvenile judges, or judges who are assigned to the juvenile division that deal with these cases, in every single one of those cases, the first function is the same, except that in every single one of those cases, that judge is responsible for making a decision about the guilt or innocence with respect to the charge that juvenile has allegedly committed.
Right.
But the second function is the most important function. And the second function is what makes us different from everything else that the adult judges or adult courts do. And that is that we then move to disposition, which is otherwise called sentencing in adult court.
Okay.
But the purpose there at disposition is how do we help that child? How do we help that child? How do we help that family? That's got to be the focus. And that's the whole point of what we do. And we do make a difference. Not in every case, but, you know, that is a process that includes the voices of many different people, including family members, including social workers, including prosecutors, public defenders, deputy attorney generals. And so if we are able to have an impact upon that child or that family and heal that family, then we have done what our mission statement has basically said, and that is to provide healing. Now, the other way that we provide healing differently than other courts is that we have a number of courts that are dedicated specifically to healing that are called specialty courts. So we have a juvenile drug court. We have, which has been designated a model court by the national organizations.
Okay.
We have a girls' court, which is the first girls' court in the nation.
Yeah.
That's been adopted by various different other states and jurisdictions. And that's because we understood early on, a number of years ago, that girls' problems, girls' issues are different from boys. And we saw, you interviewed Dr. Chesney Lynn.
Yeah.
Well, we asked her a number of years ago to do a study to look at the offenses committed by boys and by girls. And we found that we, with respect to boys, that we were had comparatively speaking, with respect to national statistics, we were lower in terms of boys coming into the system, but much higher with respect to girls.
Mm-hmm.
So we needed to do something specific and provide specific services in kind of a different approach. And that's been very successful. Then we have truancy court. We have a court called 0 to 3, which is more on the CPS track, dealing with families that have children that young, providing them a variety of different kind of services and education. We have a family drug court. We have a court dedicated to foster youth, who are aging out, called permanency court. We have another court called Imua Kako, which has to do with kids that have aged out of foster care and providing them with support and transitional services. So the idea of being a place of healing is not just something that has to be, it's not just a concept that applies to prisons. It has to apply to all the various different component parts of the juvenile system, juvenile justice system.
This question is kind of related to what you're talking about, and I was wondering, because you're the senior judge, how do you guys deal with, say, a juvenile that's violent versus a juvenile who has, say, a drug offense or a drug abuse problem? And I know you're saying that the judges have this directive that, you know, what can I do to help this kid? So say a kid, is either killed an animal or killed a person, what are the ways you would help a violent offender versus a nonviolent offender?
Well, I mean, those are two extreme examples,
right?
I mean, and we have seen situations where kids have been brought in for murder,
right?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But let's go backwards and look at just, and I'll talk about that in just a second,
sure.
Just focus on what we do. The first thing is that we have, a long time ago, I learned when I was the juvenile drug court judge, that, I'll tell you a story. This is about a kid that I had, and he was in juvenile drug court, and he was about 14 years old, okay? And he was a nice young man, and all the kids that I see, and all the judges, for the most part, all these kids are great.
Right.
You wouldn't, if you looked at them at any given time, you'd have a hard time sort of concluding in your mind that there's an issue here, or that child is particularly violent or has a particular
right.
issue. But to go back, what I was saying is that, so I had this kid that kept on, and to get into juvenile drug court, you have had to have been on probation for some time,
okay.
charged, convicted of an offense, and basically have a substance abuse issue.
Mm-hmm.
And regular probation says, I can't do anything with you. I'm going to give you to this very intensive program called juvenile drug court.
Okay.
So one of the criteria, part of the criteria of juvenile drug court that I established was that, look, these kids are just as good as my kid. And the expectations that I have for this kid should be the same expectations that I have for my own kids.
Yeah.
Because they're just as smart, just as good, maybe better in some ways. And let's not shortchange them.
Mm-hmm.
So part of it is they had to be right with school. And a lot of times these kids hadn't gone to school with a drug issue for like a year or 2 years. They had to be right with the community, right with their family, and right with their disease, which
right.
was some sort of addiction.
Mm-hmm.
So as we're dealing with this young man, he kept coming back and kept testing positive. And then, I would talk to him and I would sanction him. I would do this, I would do that. Nothing seemed to work. Nicest kid. Then he wouldn't go to school. And we tried everything. We couldn't figure out what was wrong. Now, when you have a kid that comes into your court, you have a whole social profile.
Yeah.
Our probation officers do a huge, great job in terms of trying to dig in to figure out.
Mm-hmm.
And you really got to understand as a judge and as your team of folks part of that your court, what all that entails with respect to the family, because it's all connected to the family.
Mm-hmm.
So the bottom line is that we eventually learn that what had happened to this young man is that when he was 8 years old, his father threw him out of a second-story window. That's a pretty important fact that nobody knew.
That is.
And until we started dealing with that issue, we couldn't make any kind of headways with that kid. The point being is that when you look at these kids, you've got to go through different levels. So part of it may be just immaturity, part of it may be some sort of learning disability, part of it may be some sort of adolescent sort of process or transition, but with respect to all our kids, you've got to dig deep and find out what that trauma is.
Yeah.
And once you find out what that trauma is, then you can figure out how to help that kid. And when you help that kid, you help the family. In our juvenile drug court graduations, with respect to every of one of our graduations regarding our specialty courts, what we find is if we heal the kid, we heal the family. If we heal the family, we heal the kid.
Right.
And it's got to be that approach. So if you're talking about a kid who's brought in, who's been charged with murder, in every single one of those cases, what's going to happen is it's going to be taken out of my hands. Mm. That's a different kind of scenario.
I see.
Because what will happen in that instance is the state will file what is called a waiver petition to have that child tried as an adult.
Yeah.
And, you know, the law as such, those waivers are generally granted if that's the charge, if that's the case. And I don't know that your viewers are interested so much in the technicalities of that law, but if it's anything less than that, we can do something. Look, the bottom line is that with respect to incarcerating a kid should never be incarcerated unless that child represents a threat to the public safety, a real and present threat to the public safety, period. That's the same standard that we apply to adults or should apply to adults. That's the standard and only standard that can be applied to kids. So if that's the case, you have no choice. But generally, that's not the case.
Right.
99.9% of the kids that I see, or my judges see, are not a threat to the safety of the public. And, you know, I understand that sometimes there's a misunderstanding with respect to the public regarding these issues because our courts are because they involve kids, are closed to the public. And it's for a reason. But I can tell you that if you walked into our DH facility, if you walked into HYCF, you looked at all the different kids there and tried to figure out what was wrong with them or how they got there, you'd have a hard time. Because they're all from different islands, they're all from different ethnic groups, different parts of this state, different parts of this island. The only thing that they have in common, if you look really, really deep, is some dysfunction in the family.
You know, it's a great point that you brought up, because Mark Patterson said almost the exact same thing, that we have to have a trauma-centered focus for the healing of these kids. You focus in on the trauma that's occurred, you start from that point, and then you heal forward. So, and we're going to continue to talk about this. We'll be right back with Judge Mark Browning. My name is Aaron Wills, and this is Rehabilitation Coming Soon. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ethan Allen. I'm the host of Likeable Science on Think Tech Hawaii. We talk about why people should like science, why science is actually fun, how science is a dynamic and vital part of everyone's life, why everyone, every man, woman, and child on the planet should really know science, should love science, should be familiar with science. So it's a great show. People come on here and have interesting conversations with us. They tell us why they do what they do, why they love it, why we should love it too. I hope you'll join us every Friday, 1 to 2 p.m. And of course, you can see it anytime on YouTube. Aloha.
By the kids asking that question, what do we need to do for this?
Okay, and we are back. My name is Aaron Wills. This is Rehabilitation Coming Soon. We're discussing the criminal justice system and the factors that contribute to mass incarceration with Judge Mark Browning. Okay, Judge, I just wanted to ask you...
Before you ask that, let me just add to the tail end of what I was talking about. After that incident that I talked to you about, this young man who got thrown out of the window, after that, we instituted a trauma assessment for every one of our kids. Because you gotta know.
Right.
You can't... And it's sometimes very difficult to find out that trauma because people don't want to talk. You know, particularly in with respect to girls who've been sexually abused, it's not something that you can really... it takes a while. You got to work on trust. And the way that we do that is that we establish a relationship as judges to that particular child. And structurally how we do that is we have four judges who are assigned to the juvenile division, and they're responsible for a geographic area, so they only see the same kids. And they set reviews to have the kid come in so we can just talk and see how they're doing, and the family as well. And with respect to the specialty courts, that's even more intense because they come in, like in juvenile drug court, they come in every week. So that relationship gets very solid. And that's actually one of the best things about being a family court judge is having that kind of relationship and seeing what happens with respect to these kids.
Now, comparing this to the adult system, how is the juvenile system drastically different than the adult system, the way it's run currently?
Well, I would say this. You know, you referenced that article, criminal justice reform fails to get much legislative love. We've had a completely different experience. We began, as I said earlier, juvenile justice reform on our own. The judiciary, basically family court, under the leadership of Senior Judge Francis Wong at that time, began the process of reforming our whole system in a way that it exists today. And she did that by getting us to go out and convince a national organization called the Juvenile Detention Alternative Initiative, JDI, the Annie Casey Foundation, and get them to make us a model site. Because that would have, that provided us, if we got it, at that time we hadn't had it, with all kinds of different sort of help from the outside and experts and tech and stuff like that. So they didn't want to give it. JDI or Annie Casey, they thought we were too small and as a jurisdiction. So Judge Wong kept sending me or others to the mainland to talk to them, and finally they gave in and they made us a site. And so through that process, we had to change a culture. So the culture that we had to change started with judges and started with probation officers. Because the culture at that time used to be, look, you know what? This kid is going to go out and run and use ice, and we'll never see him or her again. The best thing for him to protect him is to put that child in HYCF or DH. That was the mindset, you know. And that time, also, if we locked up status offenders, and status offenders being kids who committed violations of the law, which are not violations of the law if you are an adult. For example, not going to school, not going to running away, and you know, we were sort of stuck in that sort of mindset. Not just the judges; judges were able to change that mindset a lot quicker than our probation officers. So we've been working on that for a long time, and there are a lot of different other facets to the way we were doing things. That, and it's a long discussion about the reform. But then, about 4 years ago, after we had made this reform, and part of that reform was engaging all the various different public, nonprofit, executive branches like Department of Education, Department of Human Service, bringing everybody together to collectively address these issues. After we had done all that, we still had the situation where we weren't being able to provide these kids with the services we needed to do to provide them to keep them out of jail. So Pew Research came in and gave us a huge grant and gave us personnel, and we passed Act 201 with the help of the legislature. And that completely reformed our juvenile justice system and the laws that apply to how we deal with juvenile justice. It was monumental. I mean, we got, our state was recognized as by President Obama, by then U.S. Attorney General Holder and various different folks as a model for the nation in terms of what we had done. Now, do we have a long ways to go? Yeah, we still have more to go. And are we satisfied? We're never satisfied. We always need to be better. But to your point, yeah, some of the philosophies and the issues or some of the the things that we learn could transfer and should transfer over to the adult system. And one of the reasons I know that from a practical standpoint is because Mark Patterson, before he became the head of HYCF, was the warden for the women's prison.
Yeah, that's right.
And the women's prison at that time, under his leadership, became a model for how healing and how, you know, compassion and how trying to get in and help these folks makes a difference. Now, see, one of the things that you, the way you have to convince people when you talk about these kind of things, is you've got to make it clear why it's in their interest to look, to think this way.
Yeah.
And one of the things that hits people all the time, and this is sort of one level of dealing with the issue, and it was true in the juvenile justice system, is that we were spending over $120,000, give or take $10,000, to incarcerate one kid.
Wow.
That amount of money is got to be about the same for every adult we send, particularly since we're sending adults who've been convicted of a number of different offenses to the mainland. So the question is that, you know, what I posed to the legislature when I talked about reform was, I mean, we can do it one of two different ways. My choice would be to invest up front so that we keep kids out of the system, so we intervene earlier, versus building more prisons and more prisoners, because that's not just the cost of the prison, that's not just the cost of what makes a prison run. It has a variety of other costs that include welfare, social workers, CPS, on and on and on. So it's exponential.
Yep.
I mean, we had a choice as a community. The legislature was responsive to our approach, and my approach to them, and I think it's true for all of us, is this understanding that with respect to the kids that we deal with, these are our kids. They belong to our community. We as a community have to take ownership and have to do something about it, and have to understand that if we take those steps, everybody's going to be better. And I think, you know, the same sort of philosophy can be applied to the adult system. And I know it's worked with Mark.
Yeah.
Mark did it.
And one of the things that Dr. Chesney Lynn brought up was the fact of, there's a, you know, Hawaii has a lot of single mothers here. And when a single mother goes into incarceration, then you also have the kids become wards of the state usually.
Yeah.
And the cost of, you know, housing one prisoner is usually around about $50,000 to $70,000 and anywhere in between there. And then you talk about the wards of the state. So for one woman to go into prison who may have three kids, and all three kids become, you know, wards of the state, you're talking up in the range of $250,000 a year for all three of the kids and her.
Yeah, because what happens to those kids? Those kids get placed in, a lot of times, get placed in foster care with CPS.
Mm-hmm.
And there are all kinds of, you know, we have wonderful foster parents, resource caretakers is what we call them now, throughout the state. But the fact of the matter is that putting a child into foster care is traumatic for that child.
Oh, yeah,
and they get split from their siblings. There's all kinds of trauma that comes out of that. And the other thing is look, man, I mean, if we look at our kids and we look at what foundationally has caused some of our more troublesome kids, many of them have suffered from attachment issues.
Yes.
And those are some of the more difficult kids to deal with and to help. When you place a mother of young children in a prison, and those children are placed maybe sometimes with family members, but a lot of times, you know, with sometimes with foster parents, that attachment, particularly given how young they are, that bonding that is necessary for that child's health is adversely affected in dramatic ways, which in my experience, looking at the kids that come through our court, cost us and cost them. So I think there's a better way.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. Just a recent case that I've been working on has to do with an attachment issue and proper attachment and what happens when proper attachment doesn't occur. And I completely agree with you. When that attachment doesn't happen, there's a like a fumbling around period that a kid goes through trying to figure out who they should attach to. And a lot of the things that they attach to are the wrong things, like, you know, drugs or anything that will pay attention to them. So it's...
I mean, that's why we created the 0-3 court. Because we saw in the CPS system what was happening before that was, you know, a mother would give birth at Kapiolani, and they do blood tests, and on occasion, they'd find that the mother tested for ICE or whatever the drug. Mm-hmm. The child would immediately be placed in foster care. And that child and mother, the law requires the focus to be reunification. But that reunification is really hard if the bonding's not there, you know?
Absolutely,
and it wasn't happening because of the process, a lot of different reasons. But 0-3 made it possible for us to keep kids with mothers in that situation as long as we wrapped them around with the kind of services that 0-3 court provides.
Okay.
And that philosophy should probably be applied to the women's prison.
Okay. Well, we will be right back after these messages with Judge Mark Browning. My name is Aaron Wills, and this is Rehabilitation Coming Soon. Thank you.
Aloha. My name is Josh Green. I'm a senator from the Big Island. I work in the ER there. But on Tuesday afternoons, I get to come and spend 45 minutes to an hour with Jay Fidel and the Think Tech staff. They're terrific professionals. They help us to bring some of the leading cutting-edge topics here across our state to you. So you can join us at our show on healthcare in Hawaii to talk with leaders from across all the spectrum of health in our state, or you can join us for any other show where we talk about economic development or tourism or some really eclectic programs too. So really, we'd love to see you here on our show. Thanks for joining us and thanks for supporting us.
Talking about.
Welcome back. I'm Aaron Wills. This is Rehabilitation Coming Soon, and we're discussing the criminal justice system with Judge Mark Browning. Judge, there's been a lot of discussion in the past few years about whether juveniles, those under age 18, should ever be treated as adults in our criminal justice system because, as some contend, the adolescent brain is not fully developed until age 18 or even later. Do you think there are instances where juveniles should be tried as adults?
I can't answer that question. And the reason I can't answer that question is, look, I think that first off, that there, all the research and all the science shows and has demonstrated quite completely that the adolescent brain is a completely different brain than the brain of an adult.
Yeah,
and essentially what it is that, you know, the adolescent brain is such that we, you know, the decision and judgment part of the brain is not fully connected to the various different parts of the brain. And that's why kids act impulsively. And that's why kids don't consider the risks. They don't think of tomorrow. They don't think of, you know, 2 weeks from now or 3 weeks now. I have three children of my own, and I'm there to remind my children what to think and how to think of their future and make sure that that happens. But that's not true in every family, you know? And so, you know, the understanding of the way the adolescent brain is significant and important in terms of trying to address all the various different sort of problems these kids have and how they come to us. Now, having said that, you know, it's also important to understand that some studies show that the adolescent brain with respect to males doesn't completely form and is not completely complete until the age of 23, which if you look at the statistics for arrests, the arrest for males between 18 and 25 is significantly higher than after that time, which I believe is a direct correlation between brain development. Now, the legislature made a choice a long time ago and passed legislation that allows the prosecutor to file a petition for waiver.
A waiver, yeah.
And I have to hear this as a senior judge. So it would not be, and one of the things that I ascribe to as a judge is my responsibility to follow the law. And there are many times, not just this issue, but a variety of different issues, that issues come in front of a judge and I'm speaking in general, that we may not personally feel is the right thing, that the actual result, if you apply the law, is not the fair or right thing. But the reality is that when you swear to, one of the things you do as a judge is you raise your right hand and you swear to follow the law,
right.
And that's your choice. I mean, and once you do that, you've got to do it. If judges simply decided to make decisions based upon their own personal beliefs, there'd be no consistency.
Yeah, that's right.
And I think it would be chaos. And there's also the doctrine of separation of powers, which is really what I'm talking about. And that is, if the legislature gives us law, we have to apply it.
Well, on a different subject, I don't know if this really occurs in the juvenile justice system as much as it does in the adult system, but what are your feelings about statutes that force mandatory minimums and deprive judges of sentencing discretion? Do you guys have that issue?
I don't sit on the adult criminal calendar where they have that issue.
Okay. Oh, okay.
And, but I understand the issue. And I think if you'd ask any of us, you know, charges may be the same from case to case, but the particular situation, human situation, is not the same. And so judges should have the discretion, since he or she is in the best position to look at the facts and make allowances for certain particular issues or facts, to have the discretion to issue those kinds of decisions. Now, you know, that's not what the law is at this point, and as I said, we as judges have to respect that.
Right.
But I think that makes for more just results. And, you know, I think we've seen nationally with laws that, you know, the three strikes you're out laws,
mm-hmm.
that, you know, we have, one of the results of that has been that we have more individuals in prison than almost any nation in the world.
That's correct, yeah.
And people change.
Absolutely.
So, you know, is that, I mean, it somehow from a personal sort of basis, it doesn't make sense to me.
No, I agree completely. And so currently there's no juvenile statutes on the record that require, like, say, if someone does a horrible crime at 14, they have to stay in until 18. So there's nothing in, okay, good.
No.
That means you guys have the full discretion to help them out. That's awesome. Well, a couple of other things that are kind of going on right now is, as you're aware of, the state is trying to plan to build a new OCCC because OCCC is dilapidated, it's falling apart. It was built in 1916. The preliminary reports are telling us that the state will probably continue its relationship with CCA and build another silo for warehousing criminals. Maybe right next to Jalapa or on top of Jalapa. There's been a lot of ideas kind of been floated around. What's your idea about what they should do with OCCC, and are you in favor of them continuing to do what they've been doing?
Yeah, I don't mean to duck issues, but that again is a political question.
Okay.
And it's not something that judges can be involved in. Let me say this. You know, I think, and to some degree, HYCF is instructive.
Right.
And I'm not taking a position one way or the other, but I just want to talk about the history of HYCF. When HYCF was conceived and built, the idea was that they would construct a facility for just 30 kids for the whole state. Okay?
Okay.
And when Family Court, who was part of that discussion, this is years ago, got involved and gave their input. One of the things they said was, look, man, I mean, you know, we can anticipate a situation where we're going to be faced with a facility that's completely overcrowded because we're talking about the whole state, not just Oahu.
Right.
Now, one of the responses, and this was part of the vision, is that what would be created and why it would work is there would be a series of step-down sort of wraparound services,
yeah.
type of programs and facilities that would not be incarceration, but would be such that children, depending upon the degree of whatever the issue was, would be able to get the kind of services and healings and families as well, short of incarceration. Now, what happened was, is the promises were made, but the promises weren't fulfilled. And so the only thing that ever occurred was the building of that facility. So at one point, and let's go back 5 or 6 years ago, there were 60 or 70 kids in that facility, over and above the 30 beds that had been built.
Wow.
Now, as a result of the reforms that we have, you know, instituted, the population at HYCF has dropped 70-something percent.
Yeah, that's what Mark said, yeah.
And we're really proud of that. So at any given time, the population's maybe 10, 12, 20, but nothing close to the way it used to be 5 years ago. Same thing is true at DH. When I first started as a judge, and years after that, until we started our reform, we used to have maybe 50 or 60 kids at DH.
Right.
That's crazy. Now, today, because I get a census population every single day, the population at DH for the whole state is 20. And we've been as low as 5. One day we were 3.
Wow.
So, I mean, I think it's about, you know, how do you want to philosophically approach these issues?
Right.
You know, and our approach has worked. Because one of the things we've kept track of is, okay, if we reduce the population, because, you know, one of the things that we did with JDI that I talked about earlier, reform, was we had to be data-driven. So we had to study these things and make sure what we were doing was the right thing. All the data has shown that the recidivism has gone down. There have been less filings for felonies. So even though we're incarcerating less kids, a lot less kids, the number of offenses has gone down dramatically. So it means it's working, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, it's a lesson. Some of the lessons that we've learned are open to others who were involved in that process to look at and decide whether or not it's worth looking at.
Well, I wanted, right before we close here, I wanted to get your thoughts on one thing that Dr. Chesney Lind, and I brought the same thing up with Warden Patterson, because she made a statement, and I says, well, do you agree with this? And he says, yes, I agree with her completely. And the statement went like this. Dr. Chesney Lind pretty much said that right now, we could go to the women's prison and release every single one of them, because nobody in there poses a danger to the community, and that would release 200 prisoners out of the prison, and we could do community supervision with them and probation or whatnot. And so I was like, well, that's a drastic statement, because I've never heard of that we could just release them all. And then I got Mark Patterson coming on the show, and Warden Patterson said the same thing. He says, yes, we could. And so I was just wondering, I mean, do you feel along those lines, that same as those two, that maybe they don't pose a risk to society at the point so that we don't have to house them over there? We could release all 200 or however many we have over there right now?
You know, anybody should know it's Mark Patterson, because he used to run the facility.
Right.
He used to be the warden. But I would say that it's not as simple as that. You know, and I take it, I make that statement based upon what I know about kids in the juvenile justice system. People need help.
Yeah.
You got to have the services to help these folks. You can't just say, okay, go away. One of the things we found, let me give you some statistics, okay? And I'll analogize between that and what I see with respect to the women's room. 80% of the kids that come through our door have substance abuse issues. 80%.
Right.
That's huge.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen kids as young as 10 that I've personally dealt with who are ice addicts. Came from a wealthy family, living in Manoa. Other kids, same issue, different parts of the island. It's not economics, it's not poverty, it has to do with family. That family needed help, 10-year-old. Now, you know, the reality is that we have a variety of different treatment programs for adults, but for kids, we don't have that much. So we needed to build an infrastructure to be able to address that issue if we're really gonna help these kids. You can't just ignore them.
Right.
If we look at the mental health issues that you see across the state with adults and variety of different ways that you, I mean, no, you can't walk down the street without seeing something that alerts you that there's a mental health issue in most communities, particularly when some of the things we see in our homeless population today. 60% of the kids that we see in our system have mental health issues. I've seen kids cut themselves to the place and point when I've looked at their arms, the skin on their arms doesn't look like skin, it looks like leather. I can't tell you the number of kids that I've had to deal with that I've known that have attempted suicide. I can't tell you, sadly, one of the things you carry in this job is you lose people.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in the last 2 months, we've had 3 kids attempt suicide and one who actually did commit suicide. And so what I'm saying is that, you know, really when we talk about mental health and emotional issues, there's really not much here in the state of Hawaii. You know, we end up sending, unfortunately, a lot of the kids that have serious issues to the mainland because we don't seem to have the ability to create a program to help them here. I don't understand that. Mm-hmm. I don't understand that. To me, you know, it's a social justice issue, and it's an issue that we as a community need to take ownership of. And I could give you a variety of different examples. Now, you know, I cannot fathom that the same is not true for those women who are in that prison.
Mm-hmm.
That there are individuals in that prison who have issues, whether it be mental health, whether it be drugs, whether it be family, that need services and need help.
Yeah.
If we're able to create the network, if we're able to create a foundation of compassion that addresses a lot of the trauma that these individuals have been through to help them be productive and to help them be the kind of individuals that they were born to be, then so be it. Let's do it. But I disagree with Chesney Lynn that it's that simple.
Well, that's all the time we have for today, Judge Brown. I want to thank you for your time and your concern about
this.
Thank you
very, very much.
Super informative, and I really appreciate it.
No, it's a pleasure.
So join us next week for another show of Rehabilitation coming soon as we continue our discussion on the mass incarceration practices of the United States and their effect on Hawaii. And stay tuned because coming up next is Sustainable Hawaii with Kirsten Turner. Thank you.